Eric Araujo is Vice President and General Counsel of the Center for Inquiry, Director of CFI's Legal Programs, and CFI's Representative to the United Nations. He graduated from Harvard College with an AB in Physics. And earned a Juris Doctor from Harvard Law School. Now that's pretty impressive too. Where he served as senior editor of the Harvard Civil Rights, Civil Liberties Law Review. Now that's impressive as well. During his college years, he was the founding president of the Campus Free Thought Alliance and of the Harvard Secular Society. And now, speaking on Science in the Courtroom, an examination of the role reason plays or doesn't play in modern law, please welcome Derek Araujo.
Thank you so much, and thank you, Andrew. It's great to be back at Ethical Culture. I enjoy coming here every time. It's wonderful to be here again. Just a slight correction. I actually did leave the Center for Inquiry's employment about a month ago. I'm going to be pursuing PhD studies in physics, my old studies. Here in Columbia starting this September. So if there are any lawyers who want to work for the Center for Inquiry, I encourage you to apply. This is a talk I've given on a number of occasions for the Center for Inquiry, and it's one I particularly enjoy giving because it explores the intersection of two fields I find to be very fascinating, each for different reasons, law and science. So the title is Science in the Courtroom, an Examination of the Role Reason Plays or Doesn't Play in Modern Law. So I'll start by telling you what we won't be discussing today. We will not be discussing some ideas that have been written about by many academics and writers, issues of science in the courtroom from the perspective of the legal rules of evidence, what kind of evidence is allowed in court, and what kind is barred, science versus pseudoscience in evidence, and so on. These are fascinating and important topics, but they're not my main concern this morning. Others have chided innumeracy among judges and lawyers by pointing out arithmetic errors or the misapplication of mathematical formulae in court opinions. So for instance, the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court of the United States, John Roberts, proudly dropped a basic formula of geometry into a recent opinion, perhaps in an effort to lend his writing a veneer of mathematical rigor. He wrote that the surface area of a sphere is pi r squared. And here the Chief Justice was off only by a factor of four. Which is to say that there is now a strong legal argument that under the supreme law of the land in the United States, one is in fact equal to four. Now, for the moment, I'm going to forgive the Chief Justice and his law clerks their ignorance of basic geometry. I'm not concerned here with foolish errors of this kind. Rather, I'd like to explore the very methods of reasoning employed by judges, lawyers, and jurors that so often go awry. Now, in my experience, many, perhaps most lawyers, have a limited understanding of mathematics and the sciences. It's not a part of the basic law school curriculum. And what's true for lawyers is equally true of judges, and probably even more true of the average juror. And this is a problem. I would argue that our justice system suffers from a lack of appreciation of basic concepts in mathematics and science in ways that are detrimental to justice. So we'll explore this theme through examining four examples of what I call law gone wrong. And in each case, we'll take a look at a basic concept in science or mathematics, and then we'll see how that concept has been misapplied in legal contexts. So we'll begin with an overview of some very basic ideas in probability theory. I have no doubt that you're aware of this already, but a quick refresher can't hurt. So we'll begin by looking at dependent versus independent events. Now, when you're trying to figure out the chances that two or more events will happen, you have to distinguish between two kinds of events. There are independent events and dependent events. So if you consider two events, call them event A and event B, We say that the events are independent if the occurrence of one event has no impact on the chance of the other event occurring. And the classic example there is flipping a coin. No matter how many times you flip a coin, even if you flip 10 heads in a row, your chance of landing a head on the heads on the next flip is always 50-50. And the same is true when you roll a fair six-sided die. The chance of getting any particular number is 1 in 6. Now, to get the joint probability of independent events, we simply multiply the probability of the two events taken independently. So the probability of A and B occurring together is simply the probability of A multiplied by the probability of B. So, for instance, if you flip a coin twice in a row, the chance that you're going to land two heads is 1/2 by 1/2. If you flip a coin and then roll a six-sided die, the chance that you roll a one on the die and you flip a head on the coin is going to be 1/2 times 1/6. You simply multiply, nice and easy. But you can't do this when events are dependent. When you're looking for the joint probability of dependent events, you can't multiply. And the classic example here is drawing cards successively from a deck of cards and not replacing them after you've drawn. Now, the probability that you're going to draw an ace on your first draw is going to be 4 out of 52. There are 52 cards in a deck, and there are 4 aces. So 4 out of 52, that's the same as 1 out of 13. But the probability that you can draw 2 aces from a deck, drawing successively, is not 1/13 multiplied by 1/13. Why is that? Well, the probability that you're going to draw an ace on the second draw is not 1/13. After you've drawn that first ace, there are only 51 cards left in the deck, and 3 of them are aces. So your probability on the second try of drawing an ace is actually 3 out of 51. The occurrence of that first event, drawing an ace, had an impact on the probability that the second event would occur. So the probability that you're going to draw 2 aces in a row turns out to be 1 in 221, and we'll have a closer look at calculating the probability of dependent events a little bit later on. Now, what does all of this have to do with the law? Well, usually when I give this talk, I start by talking about jury instructions in civil cases. But I'm going to skip that in the interest of time and because it's a little bit boring. So I'm going to skip ahead, and why don't we jump to examples from criminal law? Much more exciting. Now, Richard Dawkins wrote a very insightful article a few years ago criticizing the common notion that jury decisions are trustworthy because of their unanimity. And this has a lot to do difference between dependent and independent events. So Dawkins challenges the notion that 12 people coming to a unanimous decision of guilt beyond a reasonable doubt gives us a very high degree of confidence in the verdict simply because it's 12 people coming to the same decision. This notion that 12 people coming to the same decision beyond a reasonable doubt somehow gives us a higher degree of confidence. This notion sort of underlies the very concept of trial by jury, because surely if 12 people examine the evidence and conclude that the defendant is guilty, we have a greater assurance that the defendant is in fact guilty. But there's an underlying assumption here, and that assumption is that if you increase the number of samples of jurors' opinions, you yield an increased confidence in the accuracy of the verdict. And Dawkins questions this. He asks us to compare this to something else from the world of science. He asks us to consider testing a hypothesis regarding herring gulls. Now, herring gulls have this interesting behavioral quirk. Whenever they get a herring gull chick gets hungry, it tends to pick at the underside of its mother's bill in order to induce the mother to regurgitate some lunch for it to eat. And the hypothesis is that the gull chicks have developed this instinct to peck at this conspicuous red spot underneath their mother's bill. And Dawkins says that you can test for this in a very simple way. You can compare the response of chicks when you present them with a bill with a red spot on the underneath and a bill with another color, like a blue spot. And he says, well, if you test a single chick, the first chick picks a color, and the probability that the second chick will pick that same color is going to, by chance alone, if there's no influence other than just chance, it's going to be 50-50 because there are two colors. So the probability of agreement between two chicks chosen at random, by chance alone, is 1 out of 2. If you test a third chick, there's now only a 25% chance that they are agreeing by chance alone. It's 1/2 by 1/2, you multiply the probabilities. And if you increase all the way to 12 chicks, you find that the chance that these chicks all agree with each other by chance alone is actually 1 in 2,048. That's pretty small. So it looks like it's enough to test 12 chicks to conclude that it's not by mere chance alone that the chicks are picking out these right spots. But of course, this assumes that there's independent sampling of chicks. And Dawkins says to us, well, imagine that you did this test differently. Imagine that instead of testing each chick in isolation, we took 12 chicks all together, and we test to see where they go. Do they go to the red bill, or they go to the blue bill? If they all agree, when we test them together, all of a sudden our confidence in the result evaporates, because chicks have this tendency to imitate each other. And if the fastest chick or the most assertive chick rushes over for the red spot, then all the rest might simply follow. So Professor Dawkins argues that jurors are like chicks. Now, we employ 12-member juries, at least in part, because of the sense that their result will be more accurate. But as Dawkins says, in practice, juries are massively swayed by one or two vocal individuals, and there's also a strong pressure to conform to a unanimous verdict, which further undermines the principle of independent data. Increasing the number of jurors doesn't help. What you have to increase is the number of independent verdict-reaching units. And I have to say, from my experience as a practicing attorney and as a one-time jury member, I think Professor Dawkins is fairly right. So how do you improve the legal system in light of this problem? Well, you could have multiple 12-person juries deciding the same case. That, of course, would be prohibitively expensive and onerous. You could instead isolate each of the 12 jurors from each other. But then you would lose this wonderful benefit that you get out of a jury system when you have a group collectively making a decision, and each member brings his or her own experience and expertise to bear. So Dawkins suggests instead having two juries of 6 people at every trial, and each group of 6 would have to be completely sequestered from the other, and both groups would have to reach the same verdict for an outcome to be valid. And he calls this the two-verdict concordance test. Now, my point isn't that we should necessarily endorse Professor Dawkins' proposal, but this example does serve to remind us not to put too much weight on unanimous verdicts. This is one of the many instances in which our common sense notions about probability are leading the legal system astray. Now, the second example I'd like to explore involves the conjunction fallacy and the probability of settlement. So it's a basic law of probability that the chance that two events will both occur simultaneously cannot be any greater than the probability that each will occur individually. Now, why is that? Well, logically, the chance that event A will occur is the sum of two different probabilities. It's the chance that event A will happen along with event B, plus the chance that A will happen without B happening. So, the probability that A and B will occur has to be equal to the probability that that single event A will occur minus something more, the probability that A will occur without B. So the probability of the joint events happening has to be less than the probability of a single event. Now, this basic idea sounds intuitive, but in practice, educated people have a difficult time grasping it. For instance, if you survey medical doctors, as some cognitive psychologists did a few years ago, they found that it was very common for them to make a mistake. They found that when they presented a group of medical internists with a patient who had a very serious problem, a pulmonary embolism or a blood clot in the lung, they asked the doctors to weigh the probabilities of two different things. Now, some symptoms of this pulmonary embolism are fairly uncommon. For instance, paralysis happens in a very small number of cases. Other symptoms are very common indeed, like shortness of breath. And when these medical internists were asked which is more likely, that the embolism victim will suffer paralysis, or that the embolism victim will suffer paralysis and shortness of breath, it turns out that 91% of doctors said that it was more likely for the latter to occur. And that simply can't be the case, because if somebody is suffering paralysis and shortness of breath, then of course they're suffering paralysis to begin with. Now, you might think that perhaps these doctors misinterpreted the question. Maybe they thought that victims suffering paralysis implied that they didn't suffer shortness of breath as well. And the cognitive psychologist thought about this, and they tried to explain things to the doctor, and still a majority of them clung to their initial position. So this shows that even fairly sophisticated people have a difficult time grasping this concept. Now, this kind of mistake can lead to wrong assessments in the law. What's more likely? That the defendant, after discovering the body, left the crime scene, or that after discovering the body, the defendant left the crime scene because he feared being accused of murder? Although the second is less likely, logically, than the first, it may sound more plausible to jurors. And jurors have this tendency to latch onto scenarios that sort of ring true. So this kind of mistake also has a bearing on the dynamics of lawsuit settlement negotiations. A common question lawyers get from their clients is, what are the chances that this case will end in acquittal or in a settlement? And attorneys tend to offer their advice based on their personal estimate of the relative likelihood of the possible outcomes. But studies show that they assign higher probabilities to contingencies when they're described in greater detail. So for instance, back in the 1990s, President Clinton was sued by Paula Jones for sexual harassment, and 200 lawyers were polled, and they were asked to predict the chance that the trial would not close to a finish for whatever variety of reasons. Perhaps the case would be settled, it might be dismissed by a judge, the charges might be withdrawn. And researchers looked at the lawyers in two groups. 100 lawyers were simply asked the general question of whether the trial would reach an early finish. The other 100 were asked if the trial would end, but because of particular causes, because it would settle, because the judge would dismiss. And they found that that second group was much more likely to predict the trial would not come to a finish. And this can't be the case. The third example I'd like to explore involves conditional probability. We've been speaking so far, for the most part, about the chance of two independent events occurring together. And there we said that probabilities multiply. So how do you handle dependent events? This brings us to what's called Bayesian analysis. The Reverend Thomas Bayes was an 18th century amateur mathematician, and he came up with a theory of conditional probability to determine the chance that an event would occur if we already know that a second event has already occurred. And his work extended probability from independent events to events with connected outcomes. So mathematicians write out that the probability that A occurred given B, this way, they write the probability that A slash B. So to wet our feet, let's start with an easy example you can do without too much thinking. Let's consider two independent events. What are the chances that both children in a two-child family are girls? The chances there are going to be 1 in 4. There are 4 possibilities. Either the first child is a boy, the second is a boy. First is boy, second is girl, girl-boy, or girl-girl. and only in one of those four instances are both children girls. So the chances are 1 in 4. Now, consider a conditional probability question. What is the chance that both children in a two-child family are girls if we already know that one child is a girl? And the answer to this question is not as intuitive. It turns out that it's actually 1 in 3. There's one possibility that both children are boys that is eliminated by the hypothetical here. That leaves us with 3 possibilities, boy-girl, girl-boy, or girl-girl, and in only one of those 3 are both children girls. So this brings us to the most common mistake that people make when thinking about conditional probability. The probability that A will occur given B is not the same as the probability that B will occur given A. This is what mathematicians call the fallacy of the transposed conditionals. It's like confusing the statement that the chance that a man speaks French if he's Parisian is, say, 99%. It's like confusing that statement with the following statement. The chance that a man is Parisian if he speaks French is 99%. So the chance that he's French if he's Parisian is not the same as the chance that he's Parisian if he speaks French. But in many situations, our intuition fails us in precisely this manner. So let's consider a Harvard question, one that's a favorite for mathematics professors who are teaching this concept. Imagine that you've received the worst medical diagnosis that you can imagine. Say it's infection by a dreaded disease or a debilitating medical condition, a genetic defect, whatever it is. And your physician tells you that he's very, very sorry, but you've tested positive for infection by this disease. And you look at your physician, you're very concerned, and you say, well, how accurate is this test? And he says, well, I'm very sorry again. The test is 99.9% accurate. That might scare you a little bit. But let's think about what the chances are that you are, in fact, infected, given that you tested positive in this test that's 99.9% accurate. Equivalently, we want to ask the question, what's the chance that you were infected if you tested positive on this test? And here, intuition actually fails us miserably. We tend to confuse the chance that we are infected if we test positive on this test with the chance that we will test positive if we are infected. These are 2 different probabilities. Unless you make some unusual assumptions, the answer is not that it's 99.9% likely that you have this infection. To get the actual answer, you need to know a lot more information. First, let's put a gloss on the meaning of the accuracy of this test. What does it mean that the test is 99.9% accurate? Could mean a number of things, and to simplify, let's say that it means the test yields an accurate result for 99.9% of everyone tested, whether they're actually positive or actually negative. So for those who are healthy, only 1 in 1,000 test false positive. And for those who aren't infected, only 1 in 1,000 test false negative. So the other piece of information that's missing from this puzzle is what percentage of the population is in fact infected. This is what's called the background rate. And the background rate has a huge impact on the answer to this question. So let's say that this infection is not too common, but it's also not too rare. Let's say that perhaps 1 in 10,000 people in the population has this terrible infection. Well, now we can get our answer. I won't do the math, but if you go through it, it turns out that your chance of being infected is actually 9.1%, even though this test was 99.9% accurate. How is that possible? It has to do with the background rate. A background rate of 1 in 10,000 people being infected means that there's a huge population of uninfected people and a very small population of actually infected people. So even though only 1 in 1,000 healthy people test false positive, 0.1% of a very large number of actually healthy people gives you a huge number of false positives, so large that it actually dwarfs the number of true positives. And the point here is that the background rate has an enormous effect. It turns out that to be 99.9% sure that you are actually infected, given your test result, you have to assume a background rate of 50%, one out of every two people infected, and that's very unrealistic. So Reverend Bayes left us with a handy formula, a theorem, that allows us to calculate these kinds of probabilities. The probability that A will occur given B is this calculation of the probability that B will occur given A times the probability of A divided by the probability of B. And if you go through all the number crunching, which we won't do today, you can see that it yields the correct example, answer for the example that we've been considering. So the point of this exercise is that human intuition fails us constantly when it comes to conditional probability. And that includes in legal contexts. Let's take a look at the tragic case of Sally Clark, the British lawyer wrongly convicted of murder. Back in 1996, Sally and her husband had a first son. And a few weeks after that son was born, he died suddenly and unexpectedly of SIDS, sudden infant death syndrome. Now, the couple was very distraught about this, but they decided to try again to have another baby. And in 1998, 2 years later, a second son was born, and he died the same way. Now, British authorities got very suspicious, and Sally was arrested, she was tried, and she was ultimately convicted for murdering her own infant children. The expert pediatrician called by the Crown, Sir Roy Meadows, he testified that the chance that two children would die from SIDS was 1 in 73 million. And he calculated that by reasoning as follows. He said the chance that any child will die of SIDS is fairly small. It's 1 in 8,500. So the probability that you have two deaths is that probability multiplied by itself, squared, 1 in 73 million. And the prosecution argued, based on this number, that Sally must have been a very, very bad mother indeed. But this assumes that these deaths were independent events. Here, we actually don't want the chance that two children chosen at random from a population will die of SIDS, considered as independent events. We want a conditional probability. We want the chance that two children died of SIDS if the dead children are actually from the same family. Then, we have to compare that probability with the probability that the children were murdered. Two murders and two deaths from SIDS are both very unlikely events, and what matters is their relative likelihood. So one mathematician later looked at the case, and he took a look at population statistics. He calculated that if two infants in a family die, they're actually 9 times more likely to be SIDS casualties than to be murder victims. Now, Sally Clark appealed her case. She hired her own statistician, but she lost her appeal. And her conviction was overturned only when it was later discovered that the pathologist working for the prosecution had withheld the fact that her second son had a bacterial infection at the time of death. Now, sadly, Sally later committed suicide because of the tragic turn her life had taken. It's just a terrible, very sad case. A second example from our own shores is the California case of People versus Collins. There, the California Supreme Court overturned the conviction of Malcolm and Janet Collins, an interracial couple, for battery and robbery. So this case involved an elderly woman in Los Angeles who was assaulted. She had her purse stolen by a young woman who left in a getaway car. Now, the elderly woman, the victim, and another eyewitness, they could not get a clear look at the perpetrators. But they described them as follows. They said there was a young, blonde-haired woman with a ponytail who stole the victim's purse, and she escaped in a partly yellow automobile driven by a male African-American wearing a beard and a mustache. Now, the Los Angeles Police Department scoured the area for suspects matching this description, and one day an officer spotted a partly yellow automobile matching this description in front of Malcolm and Janet Collins' home. And he saw that Malcolm and Janet matched the description of the perpetrators, and on that basis, he arrested them. Now, at trial, the state called a mathematics instructor from a local community college as an expert witness. And the mathematics instructor testified that the fact that Malcolm and Janet matched the witness's description showed it was highly improbable that they were innocent of this crime. And he calculated as follows. He said, well, let's look at the probability that somebody from the population would have these characteristics. He said the chance that a girl would have blonde hair, natural or otherwise, in California is about 1 in 3. Girls with ponytails, maybe 1 in 10. Men with mustaches, this was 1968, he estimated the probability at 1 in 4. An African-American man with a beard, 1 in 10. Probably yellow automobile, 1 in 10. Interracial couple in a car, again 1968, 1 in 1,000. And he said that the probability that all of these things will occur together is 1 in 12 million. And you get that number by multiplying all of these probabilities together. So accordingly, he testified that the probability the couple would fit the description by chance alone was 1 in 12 million, effectively zero. They must have been guilty. Now, what's wrong with this calculation? There are a few things that are wrong. First, as you probably can intuit, to multiply the probabilities of traits like that, the traits have to be independent. But a lot of these traits are not independent. So for example, there are very few Abraham Lincolns in modern America. Most men who wear beards also wear mustaches. So if you observe an African American with a beard, the chance is going to be much higher than just 1 in 4 that he has a mustache. But equally as important, we're not looking for the probability that a random couple would match the description of the victim. The relevant probability is a conditional probability. It's the probability that the defendants are the perpetrators if they match the description. And to figure out that probability, you need to do a Bayesian analysis. And just as with the example that we looked at with a test for a dreaded disease, the background rate comes into play. So let's say perhaps that the chance that a random couple chosen from the population would fit this description is not 1 in 73 million, but maybe 1 in a million after you correct for those errors, like the one about calculating and multiplying the chance of somebody having a beard and having a mustache. But if the population of the area where the crime was committed was several million, you might expect that perhaps 2 or 3 couples in that area would match the description. And based on that, the probability the defendants were guilty is 1 in 2 or 1 in 3. Now, fortunately, the California Supreme Court overturned the Collins' conviction, deriding what they called trial by mathematics. Judges and opposing attorneys don't catch every error in mathematical reasoning, and that brings me to my favorite example of the misuse of mathematics in the courtroom. It involves the Harvard Law School professor Alan Dershowitz, who abused statistics to great effect in defending O.J. Simpson for the murder of his ex-wife, Nicole Brown Smith. Now, if you remember the O.J. Simpson case, the police had found DNA evidence of Nicole's blood just about everywhere. It was in Simpson's gloves, in his socks, in his driveway, in his car, and the defense tried to figure out how to deal with this. So first they undermined this evidence by accusing the LAPD of racism. They questioned the integrity of this DNA evidence. And as a result, the prosecution decided to buttress its case with evidence that Simpson had a propensity towards violence against Nicole. And they showed that Simpson regularly beat Nicole very frequently, very violently. And that this shows that given that Nicole was murdered, OJ may have been the murderer. Now, Alan Dershowitz brushed this evidence aside as meaningless. He said, you have to look at the statistics. And the statistic he cited was an FBI statistic showing that of 4 million women who were battered by their husbands or boyfriends, only 1 in 2,500 ultimately went on to be killed by their husbands or boyfriends. That's a tiny percentage, that's 0.04%. Now this is a very compelling statistic, so long as you don't think about it too much. The figure Dershowitz cited is actually not the relevant statistic. Here's a more important statistic he didn't cite. Of all battered women who were murdered in the U.S., 90% were killed by their abusers. We have to distinguish the chance that a husband will kill his wife if he abused her against the chance that a husband killed his wife if he abused her and she was killed by someone. In the Simpson case, it was already a dead body, and that substantially changes things. Now, I don't know if Alan Dershowitz was aware of this error. If he was, he might not have been bothered by this sleight of hand. He has written in the past that the courtroom oath to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth is applicable only to witnesses. Defense attorneys, prosecutors, and judges don't take this oath. And indeed, it's fair to say the American justice system is built on a foundation of not telling the whole truth. Now, this argument has some validity. If there's evidence showing guilt, it is the prosecution's responsibility to introduce it. But nonetheless, it was a misleading statistic for him to have cited. Now, this brings us to my final example of the law gone wrong. We will end by looking at a common slogan about scientific evidence that is often misused by those who fail to grasp its true meaning. As Donald Rumsfeld told us, as we all know, absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. So let's start by looking at a proper use of this saying. The late Carl Sagan, he used this slogan in his book, The Demon-Haunted World, to rebut a mistaken claim that because there's no compelling evidence that UFOs are not visiting planet Earth, that UFOs therefore exist. Now, Carl Sagan was quick to point out that this argument is fallacious. There's just an absence of evidence, not an evidence of absence. Another example of proper usage of this slogan, evolutionary biologists sometimes use this phrase as a quick retort to creationist claims about so-called gaps in the fossil record. Now, the absence of fossil evidence for one particular transitional form doesn't mean the form never existed. The corpse of that organism might have decayed without fossilizing, or we may find a fossil in the future, as has happened time and again over decades of paleontological research. So the important point is that the slogan is really a shorthand. The fact that is that absence of evidence actually can be evidence of absence. Indeed, if you use Bayesian analysis, it's always some evidence of absence, and the relevant question is how strong or weak an evidence of absence you have. Now, you don't have to go through Bayesian analysis to see this. Let's look at a mundane example. Consider the statement that there is no bread in my toaster. I can easily verify this statement by peering inside my toaster, and if after a very thorough search I find no evidence of any bread, I'm pretty justified in concluding that there is in fact no bread in my toaster. It's silly to say in this instance that the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. An example helps illustrate that absence of evidence is strong evidence of absence in at least one circumstance. That is, when you look for the evidence where you would expect it to be if your hypothesis were true, but you don't find it. Now, scientists are very good at figuring out when absence of evidence is in fact evidence of absence. Their very careers depend on it. And I'll give you an example from astronomy. It involves the search for the planet Vulcan. For those Star Trek fans, yes, at one time there was an actual and intense search for a planet by that name. In the 19th century, astronomers realized that there was something funny about the orbit of the planet Mercury. Aspects of Mercury's orbit couldn't be explained by Newtonian gravitational theory. Specifically, it has to do with what's called the precession of the perihelion of Mercury's orbit. The perihelion is the point of closest approach to the sun, and it turns out that this orbit rotates over time around the sun, much the way a spinning top might rotate slowly around the point of contact with a table or the surface on which it's resting. Now, this precession is actually predicted by Newton's laws, but the actual precession that you measure happens to be slightly faster than predicted by an incredibly tiny amount, and that amount is 43 arc seconds per century. What is an arc second? Well, there are 360 degrees in a circle, and an arc second is 1/60th of 1/60th of 1 degree. So Mercury's orbit advances by only 43 arc seconds more than expected every 100 years. That's a tiny amount, but it bothered astronomers. Now, in the 20th century, Einstein showed us that why this discrepancy occurs. It turns out that Newton's theory of gravity is only approximately correct. And Einstein's general relativity shows that the curvature of space and time around the sun will produce a slightly different precession rate of exactly 43 extra arc seconds per century. Wonderful. But in the 19th century, we didn't know about curved space-time. We still explain gravity in terms of Newton's inverse square law. Now, the French mathematician Urbain Le Verrier had used Newton's theory to successfully predict the existence and the precise location of the planet Neptune by examining discrepancies in the orbit of another planet, Uranus. And he found that these irregularities in Uranus's orbit could be explained by the existence of an eighth then unknown planet just outside Uranus's orbit. So he did his calculations, he gave them to his astronomer friends, and he said, look there. And when they looked there, they found the planet Neptune. He postulated that Mercury's excess precession could in fact be explained by the presence of another small planet, this one orbiting inside the orbit of Mercury, closer to the sun. And he proposed the name Vulcan for this planet. So astronomers spent the latter part of the 19th century searching in vain for this planet Vulcan. They trained their telescopes on the spot where it was predicted to be, and aside from some exciting false alarms, they saw nothing. And they concluded that the planet Vulcan simply does not exist. So here, absence of evidence is in fact evidence of absence, because you look where evidence is supposed to be and found none. So no astronomer today who's worth his salt will say that we don't know why the Vulcan exists. All we have is an absence of evidence, not an evidence of absence. He would be laughed out of the lecture hall or the observatory. Yet this kind of mistaken argument sometimes shows up in law. And the example that I will give involves the New York Court of Appeals case from Evans v. Robles. Last month, the New York state legislature finally legalized same-sex marriage. But 5 years ago, 2006, there was a lawsuit. And the plaintiffs in that lawsuit said, we shouldn't have to go to the legislature to get rights we already have under New York State's constitution. So in this case, the New York State's highest court was called to determine whether same-sex couples share in the right to marry under New York's constitution. Now, the state government argued against such a right, and a four-judge majority, four out of six, one recusal, the majority agreed with the state. The key argument that was offered by the state was that intuition and experience suggest that a child benefits from having before his or her eyes every day living models of what both a man and a woman are like. Those are the words of Judge Robert Sherlock Smith, who wrote the majority opinion in this case. There's one little problem with this. The plaintiffs presented a mountain of scientific evidence establishing that children of same-sex households suffer no detrimental impacts as compared to children raised in heterosexual households. Scientists had looked for this evidence of detrimental impact, and it just wasn't there. But the court rejected this as mere absence of evidence. As Judge Smith put it, the plaintiffs refer to social science literature reporting studies of same-sex parents and their children. They seem to assume that they've demonstrated the irrationality of the view that opposite-sex marriages offer advantages to children by showing there's no scientific evidence to support it. Now, that sentence should puzzle you a little bit, but the next sentence really takes the prize. Even assuming no such evidence exists, this reasoning is flawed. In the absence of conclusive scientific evidence, the legislature could rationally proceed on the common sense premise that children will do best with straight parents. So the underlying premise is that the absence of evidence is not evidence of absence. Now, Judge Smith is a denizen of the Upper West Side. I pass him on the streets, and I often want to stop him and ask him, what could possibly be evidence of absence other than absence of evidence precisely where you're supposed to find it? So this shows that slogans and shibboleths, while sometimes useful as rules of thumb, can be quite dangerous when they're wielded by those who fail to understand them. Or, as I like to put it, the New York Court of Appeals is boldly going where no court has gone before. It's still searching for the planet Vulcan. So I'll end with just a few words in conclusion. I don't think it's that lawyers would do well to study organic chemistry or differential geometry necessarily. Doing so might make them better persons, but it probably wouldn't make them better lawyers. But still, judges, lawyers, and jurors, like all of us, would do well to study or review the basic concepts in mathematics and scientific reasoning, especially as courts become increasingly dependent on these methods. Now, lawyers, as we've seen, are not alone in failing to intuit mathematics and science. We've seen that doctors, too, fall prey to that mistake. It would seem that an inability to engage in certain kinds of reasoning is something of a universal human trait. Now, the human mind is capable of some amazing feats. A child playing catch with his or her parent, for instance, can anticipate the parabolic trajectory of a tossed ball without really thinking about it with an astonishing accuracy and facility. But when it comes to consciously applying scientific and mathematical principles, mistaken intuitions are a part of human nature. And for whatever reason, our evolutionary past did not prepare our minds to grapple with notions of evidentiary proof and probabilistic analysis. And we owe it to ourselves and to all of those who are exposed to our legal system, and most especially those subjected to our criminal justice system, to ensure that every judge, every lawyer, and every potential juror shares a knowledge of those basic concepts of science and mathematics that are so essential to the functioning of a rational legal system. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you for your patience. You've been terrific.